I'd like to tell a bit more about the Asian short stories. It's a collection of stories from 11 countries. So that's a lot of countries from all over Asia, starting from Japan and Korea in the east, to we go till Syria and Jordan in the west. And we have 11 countries covered and 32 writers. So the stories, the collection happened in a very interesting way also. It's a very challenging form, short stories. Because a novel you can go on and on, but it's also written by one writer. Whereas a short story would have to focus a lot, and you will see it as a simple glimpse of something. But the writer cannot afford to make a mistake in a short story because you have less space to play around, less space to hide your mistakes. Okay, and you cannot go on and on. So you have to be very focused, very much to the point. So it has its own challenges. And I guess readers would find it easier to read because it takes so little of your time. But you can spend a lot of thought over it. So that's about the short story for all kinds of anthologies. But just Asia, just Asians writing about Asia, we haven't seen too many. So, and personally, both of us wanted to give a chance to every writer. So we have some very famous writers in this, like Poile here. She's, I think anybody in Bangalore and anybody in India would have heard of her. She's written many books. And she's a much loved and respected name. And there are other writers also, like Shashi Deshpande ji, Usha K.R., and many others, many writers from India with many awards. But we also have writers who are very well-known in their own country. But I hadn't heard of them because their books don't reach India. And this gave me an introduction as I was selecting the stories. So I hope that gives the reader also that chance to get acquainted with authors who don't make it to your bookstalls locally. So that's how it came about. And I had to go through a pile of about 350 plus short stories to select these 32. So that was quite a terrible job, I'd say, because I'm basically a writer. And to read and sit in judgment and say, I will take this, but there's no space, so I have to send this back. I'm so sorry, it's a lovely story, but we just couldn't find space for it. Each time I did that, it broke my heart. So I told them I'm not going to do this again, but others will, the series will continue. So maybe I should ask Poile a bit about her story. She's got an excellent story in this collection. And I know she's best known for her children's writing, but she has also written an excellent novel for adults called Inga. And she has written short stories for adults. And this one, this particular story, won the Commonwealth Short Story Prize for this region. Shortlisted, okay, it was Asian winner, I think. So it's a brilliant story. Let's start with Shashiji's story here. It's a story called, it's a story about partition. Okay, and you know, I don't know how many of you have any idea of partition and the horrible human tragedy it was. So many millions of people killed, many millions of more people displaced. You may have just read a line or two in a history book about it, but the human experience, she has written about that. So Shashiji, can you tell us a bit about your story?
Well, I lived in the south, in Dharwad, a small town, nothing to do with partition. You know, for us, freedom was important and independence was important. But partition was just a story which came to us from far. So when I was asked by the BBC to contribute a story for the 50 years of independence, 1997, and I thought of what I would write about, because my Independence Day was a completely different kind of experience. Then I remembered that I had a classmate who was a Sindhi, and they were the only Sindhi people in the town. And to their house, lots of people came, refugees, from who were displaced from Pakistan. And the house was packed with them. And for us, you know, they were great fun. We never, as children, I must have been less than about 10, never realized the tragedy of their lives. For us, it was just kind of strange people, women wearing salwar kameez, women only wore saris in those days, and you know, people sitting on those charpais whole day and talking and eating. For us, it was all very strange. We never realized the tragedy. So that was what my story was about. And I think through this little kind of non-understanding of a child of the tragedy of partition, I thought I would bring out the real tragedy of partition.
And she's brought it out very well, because these children, they are going for a school function. And one girl, I think she dresses as Mother India.
She's dressed up as Mother India.
Yeah, and then she goes and tries to, they look at the map of India. And these kids are from Sindh, which went entirely to Pakistan. And they say, where's Sindh? Where is it? Where is it? It's gone. So it is the tragedy, because Sindh was lost to people. The Sindhis who migrated all over the world. And in addition to what she said, I'll tell you that I myself am the daughter of refugees from East, which is now Bangladesh. So I cannot tell you about my native place, because I've never seen it. I've never been there. I was born in free India, do I look very ancient? So that's how we are. But my parents remember it, and I grew up as a small girl in Delhi. Most of our neighbors, Punjab, Sindh, or Bengal, it was full of people like that who would talk about it a bit, and after that they could not speak. They just remember how beautiful the home was. And then they just clam up. And only reading a story like Shashiji's, you'll realize what the horror was to the real people who lived through it. And there's another story in the same collection by Murli Melwani. He's a Sindhi, and he would have been maybe 2 or 3 when he saw a partition. So his memory is very gentle. That, you know, these people have now dispersed all over the world. He's lived in Taiwan, and he goes, in the story, the man goes to Canada, and he meets a Chinese lady who runs an Indian Chinese restaurant in Canada. Now, there are a bunch of, lot of Chinese here. Chinese were also displaced. So this is the part of Asian history. It's not just India. And partition. In India, there are 2 stories here about Kashmir. There's one story by Siddharth Gigu called Umbrella Man, another Commonwealth Prize shortlisted story. So it's a different aspect of it, and each writer gives a different perspective on the Asian experience. So I always thought that it was partition, but there's so much more, say in Vietnam, Sri Lanka. Other countries also have faced a lot of forced migrations. Asians have been through it. So, would you like to ask me a question or later?
But you can talk about the other stories.
Sure. Yeah. Okay, Poile, shall we talk about your Ammulu? That's a very touching story. And being a master storyteller, I won't tell you how she brings it to a very striking conclusion, very dramatic, but could you tell us a bit about your story, Ammulu? Yeah.
Thank you. Ammulu is a very unusual name, but it is a common name in Kerala, in Tamil Nadu, which is it's an endearment, like Kanna, you know, or Shona in Bangla. So Ammulu is a girl who is not at all, in the conventional sense, attractive. She's dark-skinned, she's ungainly. She's not a sexy person. But her stepmother is very good looking and has 3 extremely good looking daughters who are, you know, in the market very early in their lives. You know which market I mean. And Ammulu, unfortunately, is not given into marriage, even though she's extremely good at cooking and all that housewives are supposed to do. She's good at all that. She's also a very good manager of the home. But nobody wants to marry her. I don't know how many men here would also like not to have a dark-skinned wife. Well, in the story, there are many, many men who do not want a dark-skinned, ungainly woman as wife. So Amulu is a burden, as many dark-skinned women in India are considered a burden. So her father takes her to the north. In North India, particularly beyond Punjab, in Haryana, in Rajasthan, there is actually such a bad sex ratio between men and women that women from the south, when from poor families, are actually bought to be sold as wives to men in the north just so that they can propagate, so that their family line continues. It happens, and it's a horrible reality. So Amulu is in that reality. It is a reality that we cannot dismiss or think, oh, it's happening somewhere else. It isn't. It's happening here in our country. And Amulu gets married to somebody she doesn't know, into a land she's never known, to a climate that is horrifying because she's never faced cold like that, and she's alone. Her father leaves her and comes back to die. But then Amulu is a woman, and Amulu is a woman as strong as the women who are sitting here in the, on the platform here. We are all strong women because we write about it. And Amulu did not write about it, but she is part of that strength, and she overcomes her disqualifications, her surroundings, her husband. She overcomes all of that. And therefore, the end is extremely dramatic. And a couple of reviewers, I find that a lot of reviews of this fantastic book have picked up Amulu, perhaps because of the title, but also they seem to have found something in it to criticize or not to criticize, whichever. Well, they've lots of them have said that the end is very dramatic and it comes very unexpectedly. Well, I'm sorry to say I'm very mischievous and I like to have unexpected endings and to give the reader a kind of whack on the head at the end, which I have done in this story. But let me tell you that it's a wonderful collection. It's like going to a Pan-Asian cuisine, to a restaurant where you eat many, many, many different kinds of food, all Asian, almost all rice-based. So please do read
the more pathetic of the two has now done better. So what the story is about, you see, one of the narrator, she is hoping that she'll be able to establish the old bonds of friendship, that there will be a vital connect between her and her friend, and they can take off from where they had left off, you know. And she keeps hoping that that moment will come of, you know, the aha moment of enlightenment, where one soul reaches out to the other and a perfect sisterhood or humanhood is formed. But as the day progresses, she finds that it doesn't happen. Their worlds are very separate. And it's simply not possible. The other girl, the other woman has moved away from her, and she too has moved away from what she once was. So what the story is trying to look at is, is it possible at all to have that kind of vital human connect between people? And finally, what is it that you can depend upon? It is, you had a phrase in your memoir, Shashi, that you are your own refuge. It is from the Dhammapada, that finally you are your own anchor. You have to look within yourself. And there is a boy who's employed to chase crows away while people are eating. And he is used as a device, as a centering device for the, the tremendous flux and the tremendous, the terrible churn that is going on in this, in the narrator's mind and her heart. So basically, if you look at the different stories, or if you look at why a story like that should be in a collection of stories from all over Asia, I think this is something that people all over face. You talked about the human predicament, the predicament of being human, of living a life which allows you to be yourself and to form connections with other humans. I think that is what this story was looking at.
Thank you, Usha. And so you can get a taste of the sample of the variety here. And these are all human stories. And another thing is, they are told by Asians from various countries as an Asian. So none of these writers are writing to explain a foreign culture, which you read in a lot of these cross-border books, you know, Indians explaining India to an American audience. They are very much living in as part of the culture they're writing about. So this is true of Jyothi's story. And one of the great pleasures of this doing this collection was that I had to read through 350 stories to find writers who are not yet famous authors, but who have a great deal of talent. So we have Jyothi Vinod from Bangalore, who has a story set in Bangalore. It's very Karnataka, but it reaches out to a wider audience about the human experience. Can you tell us a bit about your story?
Thank you, Monideepa. My story is called Dirty Hands, and the seed or the starting for this story came from the classic way of a what-if situation. I was walking by some shops one evening. It was almost 7 p.m. and two college students just came running towards me with a camera, and they the boy to be a priest's son. You know, there's a small temple, not doing so well, not many devotees come. They may put a coin or not if they want to. So I tried to see what would happen. I mean, you know, like if it he was a priest and not very well situated, what would happen if this girl went there and told him that, you know, my purse was stolen by your son. So this story, I mean, examines compassion and hope and tries to reveal something about the girl's nature. Yeah, thank you, Monideepa.
Thank you. So that's a very compassionate story. And just 1 minute. Now we have three more writers here from the collection who are sitting in the audience. Please come and join us for a minute. And you're going to be bombed with questions. After that, the audience can ask us questions. So we have Shikhandi. She released her children's book, Vibhuti Gat, just now here. She has a story. Then Geetanjali Shri. She also has written many, many books. She's a well-respected author who's come in from Delhi. And Sarita Rao, who hasn't yet authored a full book, but she's going to. She and Jyothi are going to, so look out for them. And any questions from any of you, I'm hiding behind them, please, because I've written nothing here.
You got us together.
Okay, yeah, I got you together. Any questions? No questions. We explained ourselves, did we? Too well. Okay, please. Mics, no? Yeah. I can't hear you. There's nobody with the mic.
It was a beautiful collection, one of my first about the Pan-Asian authors. I just wanted to ask you, you talked about the similarities in human behavior, but I could also sense certain dissimilarities. For example, in the story in the Singapore context where the girl does a midnight round of delivery, food delivery. Yeah. I can't imagine that happening in India. So I just wanted to ask you, as an editor, when you put together all these stories, what were some of the things which struck you as this won't happen in India, something like that?
There's a story from Korea called Ladybirds Fly from the South, and it's about a young man who's university educated. He spent all his life, you know, getting all his young life, getting one degree after another, while his mother slogged as almost a menial laborer to finance him. And he ends up, you see, joblessness. He ends up climbing on a rope without any safety net, cleaning skyscraper windows. Okay, so I haven't heard of that happening in India to such an extreme extent. Joblessness forcing to that level, though it might have happened, we haven't read stories about it. So that's one story I can think of. Any other questions? Yes? Somebody else? Yeah, we have. It's very scary. Yeah.
So, did you have a clear criteria for choosing the stories, or did you just flow with it? Was it were you emotionally driven to choose the story, or did you have assistance, like you had 3-4 of you reading, or was it just you?
No assistance. It was just me. So chop my head off for it. But after you read the book, okay. So I read through all of them. It is subjective in the sense, if there are five equally good stories, I chose the one I loved best.